Hey everyone, today we're going to be looking at another fun and unique topic in computer science called codegolfing. In codegolf, the focus isn't just on solving the problem, it's about doing it with the least number of characters, just like how golfing is about the least number of strokes. Typically, you want to write code that is efficient, easy to read, and simple to maintain. However, in codegolf, the objective is to condense your solution as much as possible, and that means you're often pushing the boundaries of the language you are using. The idea of codegolfing is a generalization of a concept called Kolmogorov Complexity. The Kolmogorov Complexity of an object is the length of a shortest computer program that produces the object as output. This can create a pretty unreadable solution, so therefore it is best to keep this style as a hobby. Although aesthetically pleasing, using less characters has little correlation with a solution being better or more efficient. Again, there are cases where this may be true, but in general, a developer's time is a lot more expensive than a server, so maintainability is often a good metric to optimize. So what exactly does a codegolf solution look like? Let's swap to an editor real quick and take a look at this basic Fibonacci problem that most people have probably already been exposed to at some point in their career. I pulled this version of the problem from the code.golf site, which is a great resource if you are interested in this topic. They have a ton of challenges available on the site, and I'll leave a link in the description for you to explore it more. Anyways, here's the problem. The Fibonacci numbers are a numerical sequence in which each number is the sum of the two preceding numbers. So here we can see we have Fibonacci of 0 equal to 0 and Fibonacci of 1 equal to 1, which are the first two numbers. And then from there we add 0 and 1, which equals 1, and then 1 and 1, which equals 2, 1 and 2, 3, 2 and 3, 5, 3 and 5, 8, and 5 and 8, 13, and so on. So our goal will be to print the first 31 Fibonacci numbers from f of 0 equals 0 to f of 30 equals 832,040, and this is going to be inclusive, and we'll print them each on a separate line. So the first solution we'll explore is a standard recursive solution to this problem. As you notice, it is pretty simple and readable at first glance. Essentially, we have a Fibonacci function with one parameter n. There are two base cases, one that returns 0 if n is 0, and one that returns 1 if n is 1. For those who are unfamiliar, a base case is a fundamental part of a recursive solution that stops a function from calling itself. This prevents an infinite amount of recursive calls that would end up crashing the program. And lastly, there's one line that recursively calls the Fibonacci on n-1 and adds that result to the Fibonacci called on n-2. So, as a trivial example, if we take Fibonacci of 2, that means it'll call Fibonacci of n-1, which is 2-1, so Fibonacci of 1. Thanks to the second base case, we see that it returns 1. Now we add that to Fibonacci of n-2, which is 2-2, so Fibonacci of 0. And now thanks to the first base case, we see that it returns 0. So adding 1 plus 0 equals 1, meaning that Fibonacci of 2 equals 1. This is just a quick explanation of the recursive solution. There's a lot more videos on this topic and Fibonacci sequences if you want to learn more. And now we're going to call it 31 times for the range of 0 to 30. We'll pipe the output to a file to later verify that the outputs of all the solutions match. Looking at the head and tail of the file shows that the solution is correct. Highlighting the code shows that the total characters in the solution is 135. Clearly, there are spots to remove spaces, but the goal of this example was to demonstrate a typical solution before showing the codegolf approach. Next, we'll look at another solution that takes an iterative approach. This basically initializes the first two values of the sequence with a equals 0 and b equals 1. Then it iterates 31 times, printing out a, which will always be the next item in the sequence. The key to this function, however, is the line afterwards that sets a to b and then sets b to a plus b. So for the first iteration, it'll set a to 1 and b to 0 plus 1, which equals 1. That adds up to me, so let's run the solution and pipe it to another output file. Let's verify that this solution matches the previous. We'll perform a diff on the file, which compares each line. Since the command returned no output, that means the solutions match exactly. Now we can highlight and see that this solution is 99 characters. It's pretty concise, but we're about to see that we can code the same algorithm and have it be over 3 times smaller. Now it's time to take a quick look at the codegolf solution. Instantly, you can see that it is a one-liner that is much more compact. However, as you take a look at it, it's the exact same solution as the iterative one we just saw above. The only difference is that it's just optimizing its solution to remove as many characters as possible. By doing it on one line, we are able to remove a lot of the spaces in the indentation that Ruby has by default. Also, we replace the put statement with just p. Puts normally calls the toString function, while the p function calls inspect. However, it yields the same result for plain numbers. Highlighting the code shows that only 31 characters were used. We'll run this Ruby script and pipe the output one more time. Running a diff verifies that it is the correct solution. This solution is still pretty readable and understandable. However, that's mostly because this Fibonacci problem is relatively simple. As the problems get more complicated, so will the code, and that will make codegolf solutions much less readable off the bat. Hopefully that problem gave you a basic example of how codegolfing works. This topic has become popular enough that there are entire languages designed just for codegolfing, and they are even Turing complete. As you can expect, they aren't very practical or readable in most other cases, so they are often categorized as esoteric, a term we will explore in a later video. Regardless, codegolfing is a great way to learn about the unique tricks and capabilities of languages that you typically wouldn't even be aware of. There's also a competitive nature to it, with sites and tournaments for anyone to enter. And I mean, at the end of the day, who doesn't like to see a complex problem solved by a crazy one-liner? Anyways, I hope you enjoyed learning about this topic with me, and I'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching.